Thank you very much. Good afternoon. I would like to welcome my old friend, Masu, whom I haven't seen for some time. But I know that she has a great love for literature and that she has spent many hours reading. And when she first came back to our country, she spent a lot of time in my library when I was in the university library. So without further ado, I would like Masu to talk about favorite authors and books and good stuff like that.
I understood that Mr. Kutokan was supposed to be doing all the talking, but he's passed it on all to me. So he has asked me to speak about the books that I like and how I came to like reading and libraries. So I think I have to start by explaining that my first introduction to books and libraries was through the United States Information Service Library when I was very small. I must have been about 4 or 5 when my mother first started taking the 3 of us, my 2 older brothers and me, to the USIS library to borrow books every fortnight. We'd borrow 2 or 3 books and then take them back, keep them for a fortnight, go back after 2 weeks to exchange them for new ones. To begin with, of course, I only chose books with lots and lots of pictures because I couldn't really read very well. But the pictures inspired me to want to read because I wanted to know more about what the characters were doing. And starting from simple fairy tales and children's stories, I proceeded to short stories and longer stories. So I think love of reading has to be fostered very early in life. It helps if it is fostered early in life. Of course, some people take up reading later in life, but if reading becomes a lifelong habit, it helps you in so many different ways. When people ask me whether my years of house arrest were in part, I always said no, because I had a lot of books to read. And as long as you are able to make books your companions and they are there, then you need never be lonely because you can go anywhere you like through books and you can learn so much about other people, other countries, other cultures. This to me is the joy of reading, that it gives you a chance to enter different worlds from your own. It gives you a chance to understand how other people think and what kind of experiences other people have been through. And it also helps you to cope with your own life. I was very well aware of what life in prison was like even before I came anywhere near politics because I had read a lot about prisoners of conscience and other types of prisoners and how they cope with life in prison. The very first day I was taken to insane jail, I looked around for all the possible bits and pieces that I should collect that might be useful to me in future. This is something that I had picked up from books, that you never know what might come in useful. And you don't throw anything away if you're in prison and you manage to keep it, you keep it. It might come in useful, but some of the things did come in useful. So these are the little practical things that you learn through books. And of course, more than that, you learn how people cope intellectually and spiritually with the challenges of life. And that I have found to be most useful. And the kind of books I like best are the books that make me think, that help me to pursue new channels of thought. It's also a way of understanding why other people behave in a way that you would not expect them to behave. If you've read enough books, hardly anything surprises you anymore. I first went to England when I was 19, but nothing surprised me about that country. I didn't receive a culture shock. I didn't suffer from any feeling of strangeness because I had read so many books about England by English writers. I was very familiar with everything I came across. Nothing came as a surprise to me. Whereas I know that some of our students who went to study in England suffered from depression and other problems because they were totally unable to cope with the society that was to them so alien that they did not know how to adjust. So through books, through reading, you learn about other people, other societies, and you learn about yourself. Because consciously or unconsciously, you do compare yourself with the writers and with the characters in the books that you read. And that helps you to assess yourself in a, I can't say entirely objective. I don't think anybody is capable of being thoroughly objective about himself or herself. But it does give you a chance to look at yourself in a more detached way by wondering what you might have done under the same circumstances. Now, I have to admit to you that I read all the Harry Potter books, and I really don't know how I could ever have been brave enough to do all the things that those children did. So when people talk about my courage, I think to myself, they don't know anything about Harry Potter. And it, of course, also gives you a sense of humility, which I think is good for all of us, because you realize what other people have gone through, what other people have coped with, and that your own troubles and problems are nothing compared to what some fellow human beings have been through. So for me, that is the joy of books, that it helps me to get more out of the world in which I live. It helps me also to understand other people and to make friends with those who come from a totally different culture, a totally different background. And this is something that I would like to encourage our young people to do, to read, that they might be able to appreciate differences and not just think of those who are similar to them as the good ones, the ones to whom they should stick. I have been talking frequently in the last few months about the fact that with the proliferation of internet culture, a lot of young people link up with those with similar tastes and similar ideas and similar ideals, and that they have less links with those who are different from them. Apparently, this has become a matter of concern for some who have studied the situation. That instead of trying to build a bridge between people who are different, the internet, in fact, seems to be encouraging polarization, because you search out those with whom you can share the same ideas. I think it is human nature to try to justify your ideas and your views by finding others who are ready to back you up, who have the same views and the same ideas. And when you link up with those who share these ideas and views, you get more and more entrenched in your own ideas, in your own stand, instead of reaching out to those who are different and those whose differences might in fact well have their own value. They usually do, because here we are in this room, I think from many different countries with different backgrounds, but I think it would be impossible to say that any one of us was truly superior to another, because you might be superior in some ways, in the fact that superior in the sense of being better qualified, but it does not mean that you're better qualified in every way. Those who are intellectually very well advanced might not be so emotionally mature. I'm sure all of you know now that it is considered that EQ is more important than IQ when it comes to success in life. And my abbot, the abbot who I regard as my teacher, Siyada Upandita, says that we should add another one, an SQ, a spiritual quotient, the spiritual aspect of a human life should not be forgotten. And this is something with which I agree wholeheartedly.